I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB say, I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB say, I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. Here we go. We're reading God's word. We're doing what we heard. We're spreading God's love from John chapter 3. We're memorizing scriptures. We don't hide it in our hearts. And when we're old, we will never depart. Why? I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB set. I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB set. I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. Righteous seed is who we strive to be. KB kids affecting the world around us positively. We are growing day by day. We are watching what we say. We are kingdom builder kids and we're here to pave the way. Hey, we are kingdom builders, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB say, I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KBKBKB say,
hey kids, why are we still standing here? It's this way to KB.
Good morning, KB kids, and welcome to worship today. I am Miss D, and guess what? It is volume number 119. Yes, it is volume number 119, and I am so excited that you have joined me for virtual worship today. How have you been? Have you guys had a great month? I hope you have enjoyed the month of September. It is hands down my favorite month. If you know me, you know why. If you don't know me, it's because it's my birthday month and so many people that I love. Lots of friends and family all born in September. And it's my favorite weather of the year. You know, I'm a fall weather type of girl. Don't like it too hot. Definitely don't like it too cold, and September is just that thing. A little bit of crisp in the air, but still warm enough that most of the time I don't need a jacket. So I am so excited this month that you are joining me because we are here for part 3 of our Bible Ninja series. I hope you guys have enjoyed so far learning about wisdom and ways that we can be wise. I know I have. I have learned a lot from this series, and I hope you have too. I hope you guys are excited and ready for today's conclusion of our series today. It is going to be a jam-packed session with all of our favorites, so buckle up. It is going to be a good time. As always, you know what we have to start with. It is confession time. Why, Miss D? I'll tell you why. Because the Bible says that we can have whatsoever we say. What we say with our mouths, as long as it's based on the word of God, if you find it in that word, you can have it. So we are confessing good things about ourselves. So often, you know, we have trouble seeing ourselves as God sees us. But as we confess, as we put on the armor of God, as we declare ourselves winners, we begin to see who God says that we are. And we begin to act like the winners that we are. So I have my friends that came and helped me with our confessions today, ninja style. So ninjas, take it away.
I love God. I love the Lord Jesus Christ, the blessed Holy Spirit, the things of the Spirit, the Word of God, the Word of God, and the people of God. Then I love anything else in all this world, upon the whole armor of God. So I can stand against the devil's scheme. The helm of salvation, the shield of peace, the belt of truth, the breastplate of righteousness, the shield of faith, and the sword of spirit. And it is the word of God. Now I use the word to knock down, to crush, and to stop anything that is not of God. I'm a winner, born to be a leader, to set the captive free, and the lead man, and the path of righteousness. In his name's sake, why? Because I'm a righteous seed.
Awesome. Great job, guys. I always appreciate when kids come and help me with our KB Virtual Worship because, hey,
it's for the kids.
All right, it is praise and worship time. It is time to lift the name of Jesus higher. I hope you guys are excited and ready like I am. I love praise and worship time. It is my movement break time. Get a little exercise on the watch here. But I love lifting the name of Jesus higher through song. So our first song for today is Shine Your Light. Yes, Shine Your Light. I love this song. It's a newer song. We haven't sang it too many times, but let's sing it together. Shine Your Light.
In the world, it's lost its way. We're gonna lift up Jesus' name. We're gonna share the truth. We know that our God saves. So everybody shout it, and everybody lift your hands. We're gonna spin around and celebrate what we found. We're gonna shine your light.
Supernatural. We are saying that God is a supernatural God. He can do anything. Sing it with me today.
My life.
into garden. So many times things in our life seem to be going the wrong way, but you know what? The Lord, Jesus, he can turn what seems to be a grave in your life into a bountiful and beautiful garden. He can turn those bad days into good things, turn that frown upside down. So let's sing it together, Graves into Gardens.
I've searched the world, but it couldn't fill me. Man's empty praise and treasures that fade are never enough. And you came along and put me back together. And every desire is now satisfied here in your love.
Worshiping with me. I hope you guys had as great a time as I did. All right, it's time for Did You Know with Mother Crouch. Mother Crouch is here to drop some more nuggets on us from the Bible. So let's hear what she has to share with us today.
Did You Know with Mother Crouch.
Hello, boys and girls, or should I say KB kids. Yes, this is your beloved Mother Crouch. And I have the opportunity once again to share with you some nuggets that I located in the Bible. So let me share this with you. For the last couple of months, we've been talking about wisdom. Well, this month is no different. And let me go over with you what we said wisdom was. Wisdom is simply knowing what's right and doing it. So you are wise when you know the rules in your home or at school and you choose to obey them. You are wise when you read the Bible and do what it says. So anyone can get wisdom. All it takes is looking for the right information and then putting it to practice. Now, last month, I used Samson as an illustration who can be located in Judges 13, 14, 15, 16 as one who did not use wisdom. And so he kind of suffered for that. But then also in Judges 16, it showed that God did redeem Samson. Well, today I got a new one for you. And guess what? Her name is Deborah. And she can be located in Judges 4 and 5. That's Judges 4th chapter and Judges 5th chapter. Let me share with you what I found out about Deborah. She was a wife, a prophetess, and a judge appointed by God to lead and guide the people of Israel into ways of righteousness. Now, Judges was one who was a regional leader. And they settled cases between the people. And they also helped people to follow God and occasionally had to fight battles against their enemies. And you can find that also in Judges, the 5th chapter, where Deborah was actually in a battle with Israel. It's so exciting to see that God has in his word for us to follow, even with females that use wisdom. And I want to tell you this here, that according to Proverbs 8:11, it says, "For wisdom is better than rubies, and all the things one may desire cannot be compared with her." So once again, I share with you about wisdom and how you can obtain it. And I get it. It is a process. But at least you're learning how to do what is right and choose to do it. And as always, Mother Crouch always tells you, children, your first defense is your parents. If you're experiencing something that you don't understand, please, I beg of you to share it with your parents. Once again, we talked about Deborah, how she obeyed the word of God, how she told her own people how to serve him. She used wisdom. And how she was a prophetess. So when they came to her with their dispute, she was able to ask God about it and he would give her the answer. So I want to share this with you kids that you know what I'm going to say next. Yes, you are right. My favorite scripture. I should say one of my many favorite scriptures. Psalms, what is it? Ah, you got it. Psalms 119:11. Thy word have I hid in my heart, that I may not sin against thee. So until next time, I'm going to have some more golden nuggets. I want you KB kids to keep on learning.
Did you know with Mother Crouch?
Awesome. Thank you so much, Mother Crouch. I learn so much every time she drops a little biblical truth, a little nugget, something that maybe I never thought about before, or something that I just need to remember, because that's what it's all about, continuing to learn and grow in the Word of God. So thank you so much, Mother Crouch. All right, guys, it is scripture memory time. It is time to hide that word deep in our hearts so that when we need it, it is right there to help us and to sustain us. And we are talking about wisdom. So one of the scriptures that I learned when I was just a KB kid like you is Proverbs 15, chapter 1. And that is our memory verse for today. This is what it says. Proverbs 15, 1. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. So we're talking about wisdom, right? And a soft answer. What does that mean, soft answer? In another version, it says a gentle answer. You know, sometimes people be coming at you hard And you want to come back at them even harder, right? I know sometimes people start talking crazy to me. I'm like, okay, you're going to talk crazy to me? Guess what? I'm about to talk crazy to you. And then I remember a soft or gentle answer turns away wrath. What does it mean to turn away wrath? You know a balloon, when you blow it up, but you don't tie it off, what's going to happen if you let go? All the air is going to come out, right? So that's kind of what I think about when I think about a soft answer turns away wrath. All the air that's in that balloon, all the anger, all the frustration, everything that's built up just dissipates. And what makes that happen? A gentle answer. So if somebody comes at you hard, hey, why did you do this? And why? And they're yelling and they're mad and they're upset and they're huffing and puffing. And whether you did that thing or you didn't do that thing, the way you respond will have a huge impact on the way the conversation continues. If you respond and you yell back at them and you get back in their face, guess what? It's about to be a knockdown dragout. But if you stop, you take a step back, you take some deep breaths, and you turn away that wrath with a soft answer, maybe you deflate the situation. If you didn't, you say, you know what? I'm so sorry that happened. If you didn't do it, I say, hey, can we talk about this? Because I'm not sure what you're meaning. This really didn't happen. I'm not sure what's going on. Can we talk about this? So there's different ways that you can turn away that wrath with your answer. A soft answer turns away wrath, but a harsh word stirs up anger. So if you turn away wrath with a gentle answer, the opposite of that is if you come back at them, guess what? That anger is going to be stirred up even more. You know, I make breakfast for my nephews a lot in the morning, and you know, they like hard-boiled eggs, and so, you know, you need that water to boil. And so it's kind of like when that water boils, when I'm done cooking, I got to turn down the heat, or I have to turn off the heat. Because if I don't, that water's going to continue to boil, then I'm going to overcook the egg, and they're going to be like, ew, auntie, these eggs are gross. Yeah, they said that to me before. Harsh, I know. But you know what? I'll say, you know what, guys, I'm so sorry. Next time I'll do better. You know, but when the water boils, it's like that, you know, that harsh word, and, you know, tempers are high and emotions are high and people are huffing and puffing. But as soon as I turn down that heat, what does the water do? It calms down. If I turn it all the way off, it almost immediately stops boiling. So I want to encourage you guys, as you're interacting with your siblings, with your parents, friends, teachers, whoever you come in contact with, whether it's online, whether it's in person, email, social media, however you come in contact with, be mindful of the way you respond to people. Give them that soft answer that's going to dissipate, that's going to stop the boiling in its tracks. Because if you give them that harsh word, it's going to continue to stir up that anger. So we as KB Kids, we want to be wise with our words and make sure we turn it away and don't stir it up. Amen? Amen. Awesome. Guys, I hope you are ready for a brain break. It is time for Sergeant Dad Fitness. It's time to get our fitness on. Check it out. Sergeant Dad Fitness.
Are you ready to get fit and strong? Let's turn the music up and move along. Don't give up, don't give in. Keep it going from beginning to end.
Hey, KB Kids, Sergeant Dabs here. I have my boys Aiden, Gabriel, and Ethan. You see they're dressed as Ninja Turtles. Hope you're having a fun month like they are. Hope September is doing great. You guys are ready to get fit in 2 minutes? I am. Are you guys ready?
Yeah!
Okay. So what we're going to do first, we're going to stretch out, and then we're going to get into our exercises. So let's get your right arm in front of you. Put it across your body. Yeah, and stretch. I know most of you guys already started school, and you're enjoying school. Go ahead and switch over. Enjoying school, getting that great cadence of getting up early, eating breakfast. Maybe some of you are doing homework. Go ahead, put it behind your back, your right arm. enjoying some homework. I know my boys are every time they come home doing some homework, right, Aiden? Enjoying math and science and spelling. All right, let's do our legs. Put your right leg in front. Yeah. Hope you guys have been obedient to your mom, your dad, your teachers, and even your tutors. All right? Make sure you're doing that. Tutors? All right? Yeah, tutors. Somebody who's helping you study. Right? So we're going to do 4 exercises today for all upper body, a little bit of lower body. All right, great. Go ahead, spread your legs. So this part is our last one. We'll reach to the middle. All right? Do 4 exercises. We'll do some clappers. Right? What else are we going to do, guys? We're going to do some air squats. All right? Jumping jacks. Right? And the last one. We want to figure that out. All right, here we go, guys. Put your arms. Put them across. Just like that. We're going to start clapping in 3, 2, 1, and go. Same cadence. All right. Yeah. You can have fun with this. Wake your family up in the morning, whatever time you're doing it. All right. In 3, 2, 1, relax. All right, breathe. All right, the next exercise we're gonna do is the jumping jack. Yeah. Oh, I call it side sort of hop. We'll start this in a couple seconds. Ready? 3, 2, 1. Let's go, guys. Jumping jacks. Yeah. It's okay. I know people stay downstairs in your basement. You're making a lot of noise if you're jumping. 10 more, guys. 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. All right, walk it out, walk it out. Woo! Feeling great? You guys feeling great? I hope you're feeling great. You got 2 more to go. This is called the squat and turn. You ready? Get ready. Spread, put your legs toward the park. All you're going to do is squat and turn to the left, turn to the right. Ready? 2, 1, and squat, and turn. Squat, and turn. Where you going? The wrong way. Squat, and turn. Where you going? Here you go, Aiden. Squat. Oh, I went the wrong way. And turn. 3 more. Squat, and turn. Here we go. Squat, and turn. 1 more, guys. Squat, and turn. Walk it out. Good job, good job, good job. All right, last exercise, guys. The last exercise is called the running man. Why? Because we're running, man. All right, check it out, check it out. You guys ready? Last 1, 2, 1, go, let's go. High knees, man. Run. I know you know how to run. You know how to run, ain't it? Now you run, just like this. Put your knees up high. 10 more seconds, guys, you're doing great. Oh, I think Gabe's coming towards you. 2, 1, walk it out, walk it out. Great, 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 great. Guys, again, Gabe kids, enjoy your month. Enjoy yourself, enjoy school. Drink healthy, stay healthy. Don't quit, just do it. Son to dad, out.
Are you ready to get fit and strong? Let's turn the music up and move along. Don't give up, don't give in. Keep it going from beginning to end.
Awesome. Guys, I hope you enjoyed, got your fitness on. Thanks, Sergeant Dad and his helpers for making sure that we are not only spiritually fit, but physically fit as well. All right, guys, it is a lesson time, and today I have a little object lesson for you. We are talking about wisdom. We're talking about how to become wise, and today we're specifically talking about wise words and wise counsel. Now, you know, we just talked about Proverbs 15:1, where it says, you know, a soft answer turns away wrath. And, you know, I always read an analogy that words are like toothpaste in a tube. So I have a little tube of toothpaste here, right? And so if words are like toothpaste in a tube, and when you talk to people, you are just pouring out the words. All those words are coming out. You're just pouring it out. And you know what? If those words aren't good words, guess what? There's really not a lot you can do about it. Because I don't know if you know this about toothpaste, but it's pretty easy to squeeze toothpaste out of the tube, but I can't really put it back in. I mean, maybe I can try and like cut off the bottom and stuff it back in, but then I won't be able to squeeze and I'll just have to scoop it out and it's a hot mess. But, you know, toothpaste is not designed to go back in the tube. I can try to, you know, lift it up and try to shove it back in there, but it's really just not going to work. So when those words that we speak out of our mouth are not wise words, we can't really take those back. We can apologize, you know, we can, you know, say we're sorry, and everyone has said things that they don't mean in the heat of the moment when things are emotional and we've all had to go back and apologize. But as KB kids, we want to make sure that we are continuing to strive to be wise, to strive to walk in wisdom. And how do we do that? We do that by keeping our toothpaste in the tube, by making sure we think before we speak. We think, we stop before we react or act on something. Because once it's out there, once we say it, you can't put the toothpaste back in the tube. You know, there's another saying is that you can't cry over spilled milk. You just have to wipe it up and keep moving. Once milk is spilled, it's not like you're going to wipe it up and put it back in the carton, right? At least I hope not. So it's so important that we watch what we say. You know, I remember this song in my head, "Be careful, little eyes, what you see, what you hear, what you speak." We want to be careful with the words that we're saying. We want to make sure that the words of our mouths, the Bible says, and the meditations of our hearts, the things that we think about, are acceptable in God's sight. And how do we do that? We do that by listening to wise counsel. We do that by making sure that we surround ourselves with people who are going to point us to the person of Jesus Christ. Our parents, if we have teachers that are Christians or leading us in the right path, they're teaching us things that are moral and things for us, good for us to do. Those adults, those older people in our lives, even peers that maybe are Christians as well, and they're teaching us or are showing us the right way to go. We want to make sure that we surround ourselves with wise counsel, because we can't always do it on our own, and we can't always know what we don't know. But when we surround ourselves with people that are wise, then we can follow after them. You know, follow me as I follow Christ. That's what we need to follow. We need to have people around us that we can follow as they're following Christ. This reminds me of the story of Josiah that Mother Crouch told us about a couple weeks ago when we first started our Bible Ninja series. She talked about Josiah and how he was king when he was 8 years old. I don't know what I was doing at 8 years old, but I know I was not ready to be king. I know I would not be ready to be queen at 8 years old, a leader, a teacher, or anything that I'm currently doing now. At 8 years old, I was not qualified. But you know what? Josiah knew that God had called him to this place, and so he surrounded himself with wise counsel. And when he surrounded himself with wise counsel, you know what they said? Hey, your grandfather and your father didn't do the right things, but you know what? This is what the Word of God says. This is what we should do. And he was smart enough, he was wise enough to know that he should listen to those who were pointing him to Jesus. I encourage you guys to think before you speak and surround yourself with wise counsel. As ninjas, we want to be stealthy. We want to be wise. We want to make sure that we are on the right path and we are leading other people to Christ. Follow me as I follow Christ. I encourage you guys, continue to read your word. Continue to listen to those who are in authority over you that are teaching you the ways of Christ. And then you will become a true Bible ninja. Let's check out our animated videos and our puppet friends as we conclude our lesson for today. Check it out.
Welcome, students. Today we are going to learn about being silent. Many people think a ninja's greatest weapon is his actual weapons. The sword, the knife, the throwing star, the nunchucks. These are all powerful weapons, but they are useless if a ninja does not have one weapon more. Silence. A ninja's greatest weapon is his ability to sneak up on a foe before the foe knows he is there. He can strike and be gone before anyone knows he was ever there. A ninja knows that even the slightest sound can trigger an alarm. He must be light as a feather and silent as a lamb. If he is, he can slip past 1,000 men and strike his target. If you wish to become ninjas, you must learn to move with absolute silence. You must learn to control your footsteps, your voice, even the air you breathe, so you do not disturb the silence. It takes great discipline to control one's tongue, to be silent, but such discipline is the way of the ninja. A ninja knows that a wrong sound can mean absolute disaster. You know, like this. Hi-ya! Eugene's son has now learned the value in silence. He has learned that he must tame his tongue. As cool as it is to have your own theme music, it can mean disaster. Eugene's son, are you ready to listen when I tell you to tame your tongue? I am so proud of you. Eugene's son, you have worked hard the last 3 weeks. You have grown as a person and learned much about the ways of the ninja. I am proud of all you have accomplished.
Really? Thanks, Master.
But, Eugene's son, you still have much to learn.
I do!
A true ninja always has much to learn. There is more I can teach you about being quick, being strong, and being stealthy.
Is that so?
There are things you can learn about proper diet and exercise.
You don't say!
And then there are other things to learn, ninja things, like nunchuck skills. And then there are other things to learn, ninja things, like nunchuck skills, sword skills, throwing star skills.
Ooh, holding back on all the cool stuff, huh?
But if you are going to learn these things, you must learn this above all else. You must listen to your master. You cannot rely on your own wisdom. You must rely on mine.
Well, okay then.
Okay.
Yeah, okay. You want me to rely on you? I will.
Really? Just like that?
Well, what are you acting so surprised for? You want me to be a good student, right?
Of course.
Then why wouldn't I listen to you?
You haven't listened to me before. You thought you can do it all on your own.
Hey, a guy can grow up. Can he?
Eugene's son. You are not merely growing up, you are growing wise.
I am?
I am truly proud of you. With an attitude like that, you could become a great student, and in doing so, become a great ninja.
You mean it?
I mean it.
Even better than Snake Eyes from G.I. Joe?
Even better than him.
Even better than him? Oh, teach me, Master. Whatever you say, I'm all ears.
God's masterpiece, Josiah. This is Josiah.
Heyo!
Josiah became king of Israel when he was only 8 years old.
Yep.
Now the country of Israel had a very long line of kings who did many bad things, including Josiah's father and grandfather. These kings did not follow after God, and they ignored his commandments and his law. But when Josiah became king, he did what God wanted him to and followed the example of King David. 18 years after Josiah became king, he sent one of his court secretary, Shaphan, to God's temple.
Thank you.
Many of the kings before Josiah did not take good care of God's house, so it was in need of repair. While they're in the temple, Hilkiah, the high priest, said to Shaphan,
"Hey!
I have found the book of the law in the Lord's temple."
So Shaphan took the scroll back to King Josiah and read it to him. When Josiah heard what was in the book, he was greatly upset.
Oh no!
Because the people of Israel were not doing the things that God asked them to do, and Josiah knew that God must be angry with Israel for not obeying his commandments. Josiah gathered together all the people of Israel to the temple and read the entire book of the covenant to them. That very day, Josiah and all the people promised that they would obey all of what God commanded with all their hearts and souls.
We promise too!
Josiah went on to help Israel become a people fully committed to God. He tore down all the other temples and the idols that they had set up.
Yeah!
He got rid of all the people who were doing bad things all throughout Israel. And he did all that was commanded in God's book. Never before had there been a king like Josiah who turned to the Lord with all his heart and soul and strength, obeying all the laws of Moses. And there has never been a king like him since.
God's story, Josiah. So part of God's story is about a king named Josiah, and it goes like this. Josiah became the king of the Israelites, God's special family, when he was just 8 years old. Even though he was a kid, he ruled the whole southern part of the kingdom called Judah. Josiah's dad, King Amon, had gotten into deep trouble and been hated by the people who worked for him. He hadn't followed God at all. In fact, like many kings before him, Amon ignored God and worshipped false gods called idols. All over the land, he built idols and places to worship idols. By the time Josiah became king, most of God's family didn't pay attention to God anymore. But Josiah was different. When he was 16, he started to follow God and look for ways to obey him. Then, 4 years later, he realized that all the idols were stealing the worship that belonged to God. So he began to get rid of them. A few years after that, he decided to really focus on worshiping God by rebuilding a beautiful temple to the Lord. And that's when something happened that caught Josiah by surprise. It all started when Josiah sent an official who worked for him to the temple to pay the people rebuilding it. While the official was visiting, a priest who worked there told him, "I have found the book of the law in the Lord's temple." Josiah couldn't believe the priest discovered a whole book full of God's own words. When Josiah heard the laws, he realized how much he and the Israelite people had been disobeying God. He felt so sorry that he tore his clothes and cried in distress. He knew God had every right to be furious with him. To figure out what to do next, Josiah sent the priest who found the book to talk to a prophet named Huldah. Remember, prophets talk to God, then share what God says. Josiah wanted to know if there was any chance God would forgive them. God told Huldah that the Israelites deserved to be punished for disobeying him over and over and over again. But since Josiah was sorry and wanted to repent, which means turn away from his disobedience and start following God, he could be forgiven. In other words, God had mercy on Josiah. Kids, mercy is forgiving someone even though they don't deserve it. God loves to give us mercy when we repent. When Josiah heard that, he called together a crowd of people, took them to the temple, and read them the entire book of the law. Then he promised to obey the Lord. And because Josiah was king, the people wanted to be like him and obey the Lord too. Now, when Josiah obeyed, he really obeyed. He had every single idol removed. He destroyed every place that had ever been used to worship idols. He collected all the things that had been used in idol worship, in temples, and even in people's houses, burned them, and took the ashes far away. Basically, he got rid of every last trace of anything that had ever been used to worship false gods. And because Josiah obeyed God, guess what the Bible says about him? It says, never before had there been a king like Josiah who turned to the Lord with all his heart and soul and strength. And there has never been a king like him since. This 8-year-old kid was the best king Israel had ever had. All because he loved God's words and obeyed them. And that's the story of Josiah. So, in case you missed it, here's the quick version. Josiah became king. He was 8. Josiah followed God. He rebuilt a temple for the Lord. A priest discovered a book of God's law. Josiah read it. He had been disobeying God. Josiah was sorry. He deserved to be punished. Josiah repented. God showed Josiah mercy. He obeyed God with his whole heart. There were no other kings like him. And that's a part of God's story.
Awesome. Guys, we are going to continue on with crafting with Miss Iris. Miss Iris has an amazing craft to finish out our lesson for today. So let's check it out. Crafting with Miss Iris.
And now it's time for Crafting with Miss Iris, the part of the show where Miss Iris comes out and does a craft.
Hey, KB Kids, how are you? Are you ready for another craft? I'm on time today. Last month I was flying in here. You know, we were talking about our calendars and writing things down. So I made a commitment to write things down and use my calendars and all of my dry erase boards so that I will make sure that I am doing what I need to do when I need to do it. So another activity I wanted to share with you today is a repurposing activity. So, you know, sometimes you have things that we may throw away or toss away, or, you know, you use it and, hey, can this be used for something else? Like, we recycle, right? We put our trash in different bins so that when it's taken away, it can be repurposed for something else. So sometimes you can do the same thing with items in our home. What I like to do is repurpose things that I can hang up and like make artwork, or even my favorite Bible scriptures. So as you are memorizing scripture, you can write some scriptures down, make them pictures, post them up to make sure that you'll be able to commit them to memory and they'll always be in your heart by being up on your wall. So if you have old cards, you know, you get birthday cards or thank you cards or Christmas cards, and like this one's super, super pretty. Sometimes you get a card that has a verse on it, and this is one of my favorite. Rejoice in the Lord always. So when you have these cards, what do you do with them? Do you put them in a box somewhere? You can repurpose them and make like artwork and hang them around your home or even give them away as gifts so we can repurpose those things. Also, just went to Belize for my very first time. It was so exciting. I hope everyone has an opportunity when you get old enough to be able to go to Belize. This was actually a coaster at one of the restaurants. And I saved it, and I put a magnet on the back, and now it's a magnet for my refrigerator. How cool is that? Also, this is the top to like an oatmeal container. We can make this a frame. This little edge here makes it 3D if you hang it. Take out one of your favorite scriptures, color it, paste it to the front. Boom, look at that. We have a little frame, little 3D frame to be able to hang our scriptures close to us. Now, if you don't have something that you can repurpose, I'm gonna show you how to make a frame in a second.
Another thing I do with cards is, here's this card, very beautiful card, too nice to throw away. I have a frame. If we just get a frame that fits the card, now I have some beautiful artwork. I don't take credit for that, but whoever drew this card, very, very nice. Another idea I had, this was just a painting I got, nice little flowers, but when I hang it in my room, what I do is print out one of my favorite praise verses to sing to the Lord every morning. Now I can hang this up and I have one of my favorite praise scriptures to read every morning when I give praise and honor to the Lord. Now, one thing that I thought was very fun, some of you may recognize this. This was a canvas bag that was given to us at one of our Gracious Women's events. I took the bag, cut it out, put it on this frame with a border, and now I don't necessarily use the bag every day, but I can hang this up and I have memory of our scripture for that Gracious Women's event. So much fun. So you guys try it. Think about what scriptures you wanna use to put up, to memorize, to commit to heart, or a nice picture that you made. Next time you draw a picture for your mom, dad, grandma, grandpa, or anybody, how about putting it in a frame and hanging it up for them so that they can look at it all the time? How fun is that? So if you don't have something that you can repurpose, I'm gonna show you how we can make like a 3D frame. So if you have a card, you wanna take a card and a sheet of paper, construction paper, cardstock. You're gonna place the card right in the middle. And to get the effect, you'll fold the card like you're wrapping a present. Making sure it's even in the middle, best as you can. So this is how you can get your frame to make sure whatever card you're using as your picture fits securely in there. Once you unwrap it, you'll have this guideline. Fold it, make those creases nice so it'll be easy to assemble. See all the lines, the fold lines? Now, you could leave this open because it's going to sit facing you. This will be a little deep, but as you fold it, we want to make this into a box. How we'll do that is these corners here will take and fold right at the tip by itself. See? So it looks like that. Can you visualize that? So you have these pieces here. You're probably like, Miss Iris, what are you gonna do with those pieces? So now that you've folded them, just going to reverse it on the inside so that it sits like that. So we're going to tuck that down. We have the crease here. Tuck it down. And fold like that. And we'll do each corner the same way. And it folds and looks like that. So what you'll do is you'll either put tape or glue. If you use glue, you've got to make sure to give it some time to dry. So for this, I'm going to take some tape. This side so you can see. So I put a piece of tape here at the bottom or glue and tape that down. And then take another piece, put it right on top, and then tape that down. Your card inside. If this is too 3D-ish, I don't know if that's a word, but if it sticks out too far before taping it, you can cut the edges. Here's one I did before, and that would be a little smaller. So you'll take the card on the inside, and now you have a little 3D frame to put your picture or card or even a picture of yourself in there so that you can be able to share it. So, KB Kids, I hope that this repurposing is something that you'll try. Recycling items, repurposing means to use it for a different purpose. So I took a top from my oatmeal container and use it for a picture frame. I took a beautiful card that someone gave me and used it for artwork that I can put in my room. So I hope that you will think about ways that you can just use your resources wisely so that we don't create a whole bunch of waste. But sometimes when we come across nice little treasures, we can save them and keep them to share with others. So don't forget, share your crafts with me. Make sure that you send an email to Miss D and she will be sure to post it to share the things that you've done. So thank you so much. I'll see you next time. Until then, keep on crafting.
This has been Crafting with Miss Iris, the part of the show where Miss Iris comes out and does a craft.
Thank you so much, Miss Iris. We appreciate you always coming in and giving us those creative juices of yours. You are awesome. All right, guys, are you hungry? Because I'm pretty sure I just heard my belly rumbling. It is time for Snacks with Dr. Nat, and she has another good snack just for you. Check it out.
It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. Cause eating healthy can be fun. Join us and you'll see how it's done. Cause Dr. Nat will show you all you need. Say goodbye to junky foods that slow us down and put us in moods. Fruits and veggies give us what we need. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat.
Dr. Nat.
Hey, KB Kids, and welcome back to Snacks with Dr. Nat. How are you? Are you ready to make some delicious snacks, some healthy snacks that are good? Well, listen, it is September. Fall is in the air. Do you guys like fall? I love fall. And not just because my birthday is in the fall, but just because I love the weather, I love sweaters, I love boots, and I love apples. And apples are a fall fruit. So listen, we're gonna get into this today. Today we are going to make apple nachos. Right? I know. So you can eat this for breakfast, you can eat this for snack, you can eat this while you watch a game. It is apple nachos. So here's what you need. You can pause this and go ahead and get what you need, okay? So we're gonna have apples. You can take one, two, however many apples you need. We are, of course, listen, do we ever do a Snacks with Dr. Nat without peanut butter? I mean, really. So you can have some peanut butter. Look what I found, this nice squeezable tube. That's fun. You can have some chocolate syrup if you want. Now you know, this is what's gonna make it good. There's a little cinnamon. How does that sound? And also some chocolate chips. Okay, maybe this one isn't the most healthy, but it's definitely delicious. Are you ready? Okay, so I already have some pre-cut apples. What do you need to do when you're cooking? Remember, wash those hands. I already did that. And you also wanna wash your fruit. Make sure you wash it, it's all clean, and then we're ready to go. So I have a plate here of apples, and I'm just gonna arrange them, and I'm gonna take another one, and I'm going to use an apple core. All right, so we are just going to push. Do you have one of these? These are kinda cool. If not, you can ask an adult to help you cut, but I'm just gonna do this one. It's pretty fast. So you're just gonna push this down in the apple. Ooh, this one is a strong apple. So you're just gonna push it down. Ooh, did you see that juice pop up? That means it's a delicious one. Yes, all the way down. Ooh, can you see that? You see how it just peeled and cored the apples? Not peeled them, but it cored them. All right, and just push the apple core, apple peels through. All right, I'm gonna ditch that one. I'm done with this, and now I have my apple chips. We'll call them apple chips. So you can turn them over. I even have some that are a little brown, but that's okay because it's still delicious, still good. It's okay if you sneak a taste of your apples. I love apples. Do you guys love apples? All right, so you arrange it, and now here's the fun part. You can do this in any order. I'm gonna start with the peanut butter. So I'm just gonna take peanut butter out of my squeezy tube, and I'm just going to, ooh, let's see how that works. Oh my goodness, look at that. I'm just going to squeeze peanut butter over my apples. This reminds me of, like, I don't know, sour cream or something on a nacho, but goodness, peanut butter has to be better than sour cream, right? So we did that. So now we have our peanut butter all over there. You can use as much as you like. Let's do a little bit of chocolate syrup. I'm gonna shake it up. Oh my goodness, this looks so good. And yes, don't forget to tell your parents, Dr. Nat said I can use this for breakfast. Okay, so we're going to put a little syrup. Ooh, look at that. This is shaping up to be delicious. I think I was a little happy with the syrup. Okay. All right. Take a little cinnamon. Because, you know, again, this is a fall treat. And put a little cinnamon on it. Just, you know, you might like a little cinnamon or a lot of cinnamon. I really like cinnamon. So it's kind of fun. So just do that. Just make sure every apple has a little bit of cinnamon on it. All right. And then we're going to top it off with some delicious chocolate chips. Now, I'm just gonna put some in my hands and just sprinkle. Oh, I need some more? Absolutely. Put some in my hands and just sprinkle some more. Can you guys see that? Look at those apple nachos. They smell delicious. They smell like fall. Okay, are you ready? I'm going to taste one. All right, let's see, which one should I go for? All right, it needs to have some chocolate and it needs to have some peanut butter, and it needs to have some cinnamon. Ooh, that's a good one right there. Ready? That's so good. It's almost like a caramel apple off the stick. Delicious. Thanks so much for joining me. That was so fun. I hope you try these apple nachos. Let me know how you liked them. Snacks with Dr. Nat, where we make healthy food that's also good.
It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. Cause eating healthy can be fun. Join us and you'll see how it's done. Cause Dr. Nat will show you all you need. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. Say goodbye to junky foods that slow us down and put us in moods. Fruits and veggies give us what we need. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. 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 Cause eating healthy can be fun. Join us and you'll see how it's done. Cause Dr. Nat will show you all you need. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. Say goodbye to junky foods that slow us down and put us in moods. Fruits and veggies give us what we need. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat. It's time for Snacks with Dr. Nat.
Awesome. Thanks so much, Dr. Nat. We appreciate you coming on. We love your snacks. Okay, guys, we're going to continue on. It is time for games and trivia. We are testing out your knowledge and we are having some fun. Go ahead and participate and we'll come back and finish up our session for today.
Ooh, welcome. Welcome, my friends. My name is Pierre and I am the head chef here at Le Gobelin. We are the number one restaurant for people who want a fancy Thanksgiving dinner. You know, big yacht and such. Well, it is almost Thanksgiving, and I could use your help to plan the menu. I have lots of ideas, but I only need the best. So, I will show you four different foods at a time. Some will be delicious, some may not be, and some might even surprise you. Then, you need to decide which food you would rather have for your own Thanksgiving dinner, and then run to that corner of the room. We must go fast, though, because I need to start cooking! So you'll only have 10 seconds to make your choice. Everybody ready? Great! Here are your first four options. Which food would you rather eat? Peas? Carrots? Potatoes or pineapple? Okay, very interesting. I personally would have gone with the pineapple, but no matter. Let's look at four more options. Which food would you rather eat? Ham? Fish? Turkey? Or corn dog? Not sure how to make a corn dog fancy, but we'll work on it. Let's see our next four options. Which food would you rather eat? Sweet potato, eggplant, Brussels sprouts, or candy bar? Wait, how did that get in there? Now how am I supposed to make a fancy dinner with corn dogs and candy bars? Let's see if we can improve this meal with our next four options. Which food would you rather eat? I ice cream? Wait, what? Pudding? Cereal? Or syrup? You can't just eat syrup. Well, now that my fancy dinner ideas have clearly been replaced with junk food, let's just see what our last four options are to complete this sugary mess. Which food would you rather eat? Nachos? Gummy bears? Beef jerky? Or cookies? Wow! I think I have a cavity just from reading that list of foods. Thank you all for your help, I think. Also, if you want a fancy Thanksgiving dinner, please do not come to Le Gobbler. There is no way I can make gummy bears fancy.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to another exciting game of Bigger Bible Books! The fun and exciting game where you, the audience, must quickly decide by looking at two books of the Bible which book you think is bigger. That is, which book has the most chapters. When you think you know the answer, shout out the name of the book and hold up one hand for book number one and two hands for book number two. Choose carefully, though. Select the correct book and you're still in the game. Select the wrong book and you can keep playing, but please take a seat. If you're still standing after all eight questions, you will have earned the title of Bigger Bible Books Champion! Everybody, on your feet! It's time to play Bigger Bible Books! Which book is bigger, Psalms or Jude? Time's up! Psalms is the bigger book with 150 chapters. Jude has only one. Now, which book is bigger, Matthew or Joel? Time's up! Matthew is the bigger book with 28 chapters. Joel has only three. Which of these books is bigger? 1 Samuel or 1 John? Time's up! 1 Samuel is bigger because it has 31 chapters. 1 John has only 5. Nice job if you got all three of those right. Now, which of these books is bigger? Obadiah or Genesis? Time's up! Genesis is the bigger book with 50 chapters. Obadiah has only one. Which of these books do you think is bigger? Ruth or Proverbs? Time's up! Proverbs is bigger because it has 31 chapters. Ruth has only 4. Excellent work if you're still standing. You really know your books of the Bible. Now, which of these books is bigger? Acts or 3 John? Time's up! Acts is the bigger book with 28 chapters. 3 John has only 1. These last two questions are going to get a little tougher now. Which of these books is bigger? Luke or Esther? Time's up! Luke is the bigger book with 24 chapters. Esther has only 10. Final question! Which of these two books do you think is bigger? 2 Samuel or Job? Time's up!
Job is bigger because it has 42 chapters. 2 Samuel has only 24. Congratulations! If you got all 8 questions right, that is very impressive. You have earned the title of Bigger Bible Books Champion! Thanks for playing, everyone!
Wow, I cannot believe it is already time to go. I have had a blast. I hope you guys have too. Let's go ahead and finish out our lesson with prayer. Pray with me. Father, we thank you so much for all that you have taught us with throughout these 3 months, these 3 lessons of Bible Ninja. We thank you that you are teaching us to be wise. You're teaching us how to surround ourselves with wise counsel, to think before we speak and before we act, and make sure that we are following you. I pray that you bless everyone that is participating and listening today. We pray that you bless us with grace and peace, and that your highest and best will be ours. We pray for protection until we're able to meet again. We love you and we thank you for loving us. In Jesus' name, amen, amen, amen. KB friends, it has been my absolute pleasure to join you for KB Kids Virtual Worship today. I hope you had as much fun as I have. Until next month, it's me, Miss D, signing off. Bye for now.
Right to see this, who we strive
to be. Catch you later, friends.
KB Kids affecting the world around us positively. We are growing day by day. We are watching what we say. We are kingdom builder kids, and we're here to pave the way. Hey, we are kingdom builders, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KB, 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 say, I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KB, 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 say, I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. One more time, we are. I am a kingdom builder, building up the kingdom of the Lord. I am a kingdom builder. KB Kids, out. Wheaton Christian Center, Kingdom Builders Children's Ministry.